good morning, Harvest. Happy Memorial Day weekend. If you'll stand as we worship, it's so good to be in God's house, isn't it? Yeah? Come on, can we lift our voices to Him? Can we lift our voices to the King of Kings, to the Lord of Lords this morning, and give Him praise? Let's do it. Yeah. Come on, let praise be worship.
We sing with all we are and we claim. Amen. Amen. Romans chapter 6, verse 4 says this: we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Amen? Throughout the scriptures, we are called again and again, encouraged to trust Christ in what he is doing, to join him in his work to restore and redeem the world. And one way that we do that is by remembering what the Lord has done for us. And when we do that, when we remember what the Lord has done, what it does is it gives us hope for the present and hope for the future, for what he is going to do when he comes back and he makes all things new one day, right? In a few minutes, we are going to share and we're going to remember the Lord's death in communion. And so we do that as a family. This is a family meal. So if you have not put your trust and faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, please let those elements pass, but also consider where you are in your relationship with the Lord. I'm going to invite our team to go ahead and come forward to start passing those elements. While the elements are going to be passed around during this time, what we want you to do is take the time in a moment to examine your heart and to pray as you reflect on what the Lord has done for us.
This morning, we're going to share this meal together.
I'm going to read in English, and then I'm going to read in Spanish, and then we'll take the elements, okay? Voy a leer en inglés y en español, y después de eso vamos a tomar los elementos juntos como familia. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." La noche en que fue traicionado, el Señor Jesús tomó pan y dio gracias a Dios por ese pan. Luego lo partió en trozos y dijo, "Esto es mi cuerpo, el cual es entregado por ustedes. Hagan esto en memoria de mí." Let's take the bread. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." De la misma manera, tomó en sus manos la copa de vino después de la cena y dijo, "Esta copa es el nuevo pacto entre Dios y su pueblo, un acuerdo confirmado con mi sangre. Hagan esto en memoria de mí todas las veces que la beban." Let's drink it. "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Pues cada vez que coman este pan y beban esta copa, anuncian la muerte del Señor hasta que Él vuelva.
Liar.
here is thankful for the cross of Christ.
Amen. And we get to praise that Father for all that he has done for us. Amen. How about you have a seat this morning? If I haven't had the pleasure of meeting you, my name is Christian, and I have the privilege of serving as the pastor for Harvest in Español. Harvest in Español meets, there we go. Harvest in Español meets at Rolling Meadows and Elgin. And so we are blessed to be here. Quiero saludar a mis hermanos. Bienvenidos a la casa de Dios. Es una bendición estar con ustedes. Mi nombre es Cristian. Soy el pastor de Harvest en Español. Si no he tenido el privilegio de conocerte, me encantaría conocerle después del servicio para decirle de nuestros servicios y lo que Dios está haciendo en nuestra iglesia. If this is your first time here, we would love to meet you. Just get to know your story and why you're here and what you need. So we'll be outside in the lobby after the service. I would love to meet you. If you're from home, this is your time to check in using our app in Church Center. It's just a way for us to know how we can serve you better and what we can do to minister to you better, okay? So please make sure that you do this. Older men, we have an announcement for you. We have a retreat. Forge Men Are Made is going to be June 7th through the 9th. Where are all the guys? Come on, guys. It's going to be at Camp Harvest. If you want more information or if you would like to sign up, go to harvestbible.org. We pray for churches that are like our church, that are serving the Lord, ministering to their communities, and bringing the gospel to the places where it needs to go. So today we're going to pray for Mission Church in Bloomingdale. We're going to be praying for Pastor John Peacock as well. 2 Corinthians reminds us of this. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Amen? You're going to see on the screen ways that you can give. We give as an act of worship to God for what he has done and what he has given to us. And he is very generous with us, and he calls us to be generous with everything he has given to us. So whether you give today or you give during the week, we pray that you are doing it with a cheerful heart. Would you please join me in prayer this morning? Father God, we are so thankful for your love for us. We're so thankful that we have the freedom to come and worship you for who you are. Thank you for all that you have done, Lord. We want to pray this morning for Mission Church. May you bless their time together in the Word of God. May you bless Pastor John, that he will boldly proclaim the gospel to that community. May they continue to reach out into their community in the name of Jesus. We pray for our hearts, Lord. Prepare our hearts, prepare our minds to listen from you, to hear from you, to be motivated, to be challenged, to continue to go on. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen and amen. Would you please just shake the hand of somebody next to you this morning?
Hey, good morning, Harvest. Happy Memorial Day weekend. This, of course, isn't just a time for barbecues and a day off of school for the kids, but it's actually an opportunity for us to celebrate a reality in our country, the freedoms that we all experience and enjoy because of so many who have given so much for us. John 15:13 says, "Greater love has no one than this, that someone would lay down their lives for their friends. And we're grateful and thankful for so many who've protected, who've served our country, and many who've paid the ultimate price with their lives to give us the freedoms that we're enjoying right now in each of our gatherings this morning and today, so that we can gather in freedom. And I want to take a moment. I know we've prayed a few times through our gathering, but we are a people of prayer. And I want to take a moment just as we begin and pray for our gatherings together and thank the Lord for the freedoms and the joys that we experience in this land. Let's pray together. Father, we are grateful for an opportunity to gather and for the freedom that we have to gather in these houses of worship under your name. Lord, we're thankful for the freedoms that we have in this country, for so many who've given so much so that we could experience what we have now. We thank you that their labor is not in vain, and that we can enjoy those things even now. God, we would pray that you would open our eyes and our hearts and our minds to receive what you would have for us from your word today. Thank you so much for your living and active word that does pierce our hearts even. And so, Lord, we would pray that you would challenge us, you would encourage us today from your word. Would you be glorified and honored through all that's said and done today? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, if you don't already have a copy of God's word in front of you, please grab that. Open it up, 1 Peter chapter 3. Lord willing, we're going to be in the book of 1 Peter through the end of June and studying every single verse, and I hope you have been enriched by your time in God's word, delving into the depths, all that Peter explains to us. We're going to be in 1 Peter 3, 8 through 17 today, and Peter's been instructing us how we're to live in our relationships in such a strange land. We've called this series Strangers in a Strange Land, that you and I, we're citizens of heaven, that because of our relationship with Jesus Christ, because of our faith in Jesus and what he has done on the cross, what he's accomplished for you and for me, that we are now citizens of heaven. We have a secure inheritance and an eternal hope that's reserved for us in heaven. That's your home. But for now, we're in this strange land, this goofy place that we don't belong to, and we experience a lot of things that would remind us of that we belong somewhere different. Peter has been instructing us, and he tells us, remember 1 Peter 2:9, he tells us that we are a chosen race, that we're a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and a people for his own possession. You belong to God now. That's who you are. You aren't supposed to look like the people around you who don't follow Jesus. And therefore, your relationships, they should look a little bit different. They shouldn't look the same as the world's. And he's been telling us how some of our significant relationships are to look and how we're to act in those relationships. If you remember, we talked about how servants are to live and to serve, how wives and husbands are to relate to one another with love and with respect and with understanding and honor, how we should act as citizens here in this land towards the governing authorities. All of that is because we are a people for his own possession. And so it means something for the way that we interact in the relationships that we have. But what about when it's difficult? What about when we're under pressure? What about when it's really hard for us? When we're pressed and we're in the midst of suffering or persecution, how are we to live even when it's hard? How am I to live faithfully when it's difficult, when I'm not treated well, when I'm spoken evil of, when I suffer even for doing what's right? That's what Peter tells us in our text today. Peter tells us four things about how we're to live faithfully even when it's hard. We're to love with humility. We're to repay with blessing. We're to rest with trust. And we're to answer with hope. First, let's look at this in the text. 1 Peter 3, verse 8. Love with humility, he tells us. Let's look at the text together. Finally, all of you have unity of mind have sympathy, have brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. He begins this passage by saying, finally, again, pointing back to all of the relationships that he's been walking through. But here he's talking specifically about how we are to relate to one another within the church. He says, all of you, remember this letter is written to believers, to Christians, to people who are elect exiles. It's written to me and to you, and we're told how we're to treat one another in the church. Notice he says that we're to have brotherly love, that love for your sisters and your brothers, the family love. And together, these five commands that he gives us, they're how we're to treat one another in the church, emphasizing the fact that we're to get along with one another in the face of all of the pressure from the outside world. Have you realized yet that there's pressure from the world outside the church for us to conform and to look like everyone else and get in line and go with the flow of everybody else? Peter has a different message for us, that we're not to look like the world. Instead, we're to have brotherly love. We're to love with humility. And his call for us here is for us to get along, to have unity in love for one another as we face pressure from a world that doesn't love Jesus the way that we do. Our internal disagreements that we have, he calls us to put those aside and to have unity. And our internal disagreements, the little things that we would get upset about with one another, they're almost always worth overlooking in light of the pressure that we face from the outside. There's a bigger battle at stake instead of all of the little things that we might get upset about. You know, now that it's warmer, my kids love, one of their favorite things to do is to go out in the backyard and have a water balloon fight with each other. You know, I'm picking up those little water balloon things like forever. But I have three kids and they are crazy and wonderful. And they are ruthless when it comes to a water balloon fight. I have no idea where they got that. But it's every kid for themselves. Headshots, doesn't matter, right in the face. It's like, we're just going at it. Little sister's crying, doesn't matter. I'm gonna continue to pelt her with water balloons. And they are brutal with each other in a really fun way. But they're just going at it, every kid for themselves, and this fight continues to go until I come around the corner with the garden hose. Like, suddenly their little skirmish with each other, and she hit me when I wasn't looking, and all, it doesn't matter anymore. They're unified against a common enemy. Because that garden hose, that's a bigger deal than all of the little things. I mean, yeah, I'm getting hit with water balloons, but there's a garden hose here. And I think it's like that for us so often. We're fighting with water balloons and she hit me and I didn't like how he said that and the way that he looked at me and blah, blah, blah. And all these little things that we get upset about. And Peter here is calling us, put all of that aside. There's a bigger issue at stake. People need Jesus. We have a battle in front of us. We have an enemy who prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he will devour. Put the water balloons down. We have a bigger fight. And the only way that my kids are going to succeed in that moment is to put their differences aside and be unified in their battle. Brothers and sisters, let's leave the petty fighting and commit to unity together to accomplish that mission of making disciples. Let's leave the petty disagreements about, you know, what the high five shirts are going to look like this year, or who's going to get to cook the bacon at the men's breakfast, or what color should we paint that wall? Who cares? We're about making disciples for Jesus Christ. Let's quit launching needless water balloons at one another and focus together on the mission that's in front of us, because we're about making disciples of Jesus Christ. There are so many people around us, so many people in your life who need Jesus Christ. So much of our world is antagonistic towards us and towards the faith. And in the midst of persecution and suffering all around us, we are stronger when we're together. And that's what Peter is calling us to do. He's calling us to have a brotherly love, a family love, to love one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And to do that with, he says, a humble mind. I'm reminded of this passage in Philippians 2, where Paul says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind in among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus is our model of humility in humble love for one another. We're called to love with humility as we seek unity together. And this is our model. Jesus says, we're told that Jesus, he empties himself. He doesn't look to his own interests, but we're called to look to the interests of others, to actually treat one another like we believe our brothers and sisters are more significant than we are. Do you live that way? Do you treat other Christians like they are more important than you are? Because that's what we're called to. That's our model of humility. Are you loving your fellow Christians with humility? Because we love with humility in a world that desperately needs Jesus Christ. And secondly, we repay with blessing. Let's look back at 1 Peter 3, 9 and following. He says, do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. We're called to repay with blessing those even who revile us. Peter speaks now with how we're going to act and how we're to treat those who are attacking us from outside the church. He says, don't repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling. To revile is, it's abusive or insulting talk. It's speaking evil of someone. Has that happened to you before? Has someone spoken evil of you? Of course they have. Every single one of us at one time or another has had someone speak evil towards us. And I'm sorry to say that it will continue to happen in this world. It's a broken place with evil all around us. And even if you try to do everything possible according to God's word, some people will always find fault with you. Maybe it's a failure of my own, or perhaps it's just unjust treatment towards me, but it's going to happen at some point. And when it does, Peter tells us not to revile in return, not to return the evil that's spoken of towards us. He does this by quoting Psalm 34 here. And it's a beautiful picture that we see where he says that God sees us and God cares about those who are spoken poorly of. This quote from Psalm 34 begins, verse 10, by saying, whoever desires to love life and see good days. Do you desire to love life? Do you desire to see good days? Do you hope to have a good life? Yes, of course we do. So what does the psalmist tell us here? If you want to have a good life, keep your mouth shut. That's basically what he says here. Whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Stop saying evil things. If you want to have a good life, keep your mouth shut. Now, this was super convicting to me. I kind of even laughed to myself. I'm sitting in my study this week, and I'm reading this. Okay, whoever desires to, okay, yeah, I want to have a blessed life. Keep your mouth shut. Got it, Lord. Okay. It's pretty clear, I think, but super convicting, and I think it's very hard for us. It seems like such a simple thing to just not say a word. But yet it's so difficult for us at times. Jesus called us to the same thing in Matthew 5. This is the passage, Matthew 5, 38, is where he says, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And he continues a few verses later in Matthew 5, 43. I love, just a little bit of a side, I love that Jesus does this. He continues to say, you have heard that it said X, but I say to you, it's actually like that. He's going to do it again here. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That's how the world thinks. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? That's exactly what happens in our world. Everybody does that. And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? No, God wants us to be different than that. And even though some will revile us and speak evil of us, we don't need to return the favor. Jesus's followers, we don't pay back insults, but with blessing, but with prayer for that person. I just got to say, like, we know all of this, but this is a hard word for us to actually follow. We're really good at comebacks. Like, really good. Even those of us who feel like we're a little slow at it at times, we're really good at repaying evil for evil. Maybe I make food for some people and I set it before them and they say, oh, this is awful. And I quickly say, no, you're awful. Like, it's just right there all the time. That's like our nature. It's an easy reaction for some of us. And sometimes the most difficult thing for us is just to keep our mouth shut. Like, for some of us, we take such long showers because we're sitting there replaying all of the conversations from the day. Oh, I should have said this, and I'll tell her, and we ruin all the water pressure because we spend so much time, like, recounting all of those things that we wish we said and we will say the next time. Maybe your issue isn't that you specifically revile in return and have that quick comeback, but maybe your issue is actually that you harbor bitterness for the evil things that were done and said to you, and you sort of let it leak out and come out in all of those little interactions. It's still reviling, however it comes out. Maybe it comes out in those passive-aggressive comments or the treatment of a person who's continued to speak evil of us. Maybe you get that email that seems to put you in a lower place, and you're like, per my last email, send. Like, it comes out in all of those little ways of reviling, those little daggers that we would send towards other people. It's evil and it's wrong. And we're called to respond with grace. Jesus' followers don't revile, we bless. We pray for those. And not like the, I share a prayer request in a group of people, but I gotta tell you what she said, because we should pray for her, because she's awful. No, it's not like that at all. We actually pray for the person. We care about the person. Jesus' followers respond with grace. Genuine Christians speak Christianly. Not perfectly, but increasingly. The more that we follow Jesus Christ, the more that we seek to be like him, the more that we take on all of those things. You have heard that it was said. But I say to you, bless and pray for those who are evil towards you. We don't revile in return in the same way that Jesus acted. So when you look at the way that you respond to your critics, to those who would speak evil to you, what does that say about your genuineness of your faith? Are your words reviling others, or are they full of blessing? Listen, sometimes it's just so hard for us to let things go. Why is it so hard for us to let it go, to actually just keep my mouth shut? I'm not gonna respond. I'm gonna leave it. Why is it so difficult for us not to pay someone back? I spent a lot of time thinking about this week. I think it's because we don't actually believe God when he says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. I think it's actually because we don't believe that he's going to stick up for us, and so we feel that we need to. What would happen if I let people speak evil of me? What would happen if I was put in that lower place? Sounds a little bit like Jesus. Taking the humble road, taking the lower position, even when we feel that we might deserve something different. It actually sounds a lot like our master, doesn't it? And so we want to take it upon ourselves to make sure that a payment is made for the wrong that was done to us. But God would say, vengeance is mine. He would say, keep your mouth shut. I got it. What's beautiful about this passage is the reminder, verse 12. Notice what it says in the text. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. The beautiful thing about this passage is that when you are reviled, and instead of reviling, you bless, God sees that. He takes note of that. The eyes of the Lord are upon you. It's like he's looking towards you. He's like, I saw when she was spoken evil of, and she took the humble road. She blessed instead of reviled. I'm seeing that. I'm taking note of that. My ears are open to that. It is a beautiful thing for us to keep our mouth shut and leave it with the Lord. When you are kind when they deserve a harsh response, the Lord sees all that. When you're reviled, and instead of lashing back at that person or letting it come out in a passive-aggressive comment or my treatment of them, I'm going to bless that person and be kind to them. The Lord sees it. His eyes are upon you, and his ears are open to your prayer. So as we repay with blessing, we can, third, rest with trust. Rest with trust. 1 Peter 3 says, 13 through 15. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy. Rest with trust. Peter here tells us what our attitude should be when we do suffer for Jesus Christ, that we can rest with trust in him, to leave it with the Lord, to know that he saw it and that he's working, that we can trust him in that. He says to not be troubled, that we can rest in knowing that he sees and that nothing happens outside of his control. It's super powerful for us to make the decision ahead of time that I'm going to trust the Lord no matter what happens. I'm going to rest in him and to leave it with the Lord and to trust him no matter what I'm seeing. No matter what's going to happen in the future, I'm making the decision ahead of time of what I'm going to do with my trust. I love the movies with like the epic battle scene. You know, so often there's a point when the leader comes in front of their troops, probably riding on a horse, you know, face painted and all ready for battle or something like that. And he delivers a moving speech in front of the troops. And over, what we see in all of those movies is a challenge to stand firm no matter what. You know, it will not be this day that we'll fail, all of those sorts of things. They'll never take our freedom. You know, all of, like, I'm putting the stake in the ground now. That no matter what happens, we will stand. We're not going to back down. We're not going to retreat. We're putting a stake in the ground. This is who we are, and this is the decision that I'm making in the future. I'm making the decision now that I will trust the Lord no matter what happens. There's great wisdom and incredible power for us in deciding beforehand that we're going to stand. The decision ahead of time, I don't know how hard it's going to get, but I'm going to honor the Lord no matter what happens. I'm making that decision right now to honor the Lord. We see this in the book of Joshua. It's a familiar passage to us. Joshua's about to die. He's leading the people into the promised land, and he recounts all of God's goodness and God's faithfulness to them, all of the battles that they have seen the Lord win in the past. And he calls the people to make a decision to put a stake in the ground. This is Joshua 24, 14 and 15. He says, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him with sincerity and in faithfulness. No matter what happens, I'm going to be faithful to the Lord. I'm going to trust him. Put away the gods that your fathers have served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it's evil in your eyes, to serve the Lord, choose this day. Choose, make a decision right now who you're going to serve, whether it be the gods of your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We're going to serve the Lord. I'm making the decision right now to rest with trust in the Lord. I'm going to trust him no matter what happens, no matter what kind of persecution comes against us as a church, we're going to trust the Lord. We're going to follow him. No matter what suffering or what reviling I get thrown against me wrongly by the people in my life who would try to harm me, I'm making the decision ahead of time to trust the Lord. Loved ones, I'm just telling you, a key to persevering in the faith is making the decision ahead of time, no matter how difficult it gets, I'm going to stand. I'm not moving. I'm going to trust the Lord, even when it's hard, even when it hurts. I think you've probably heard me say before how little I like dentists. I guess I should say how little I like going to the dentist. If you're a dentist, maybe we can still be friends. But I don't really love sitting in that chair. There are like handprints in the chair where I'm just clutching because I do not like being messed with like that. But there's a point when you're at the dentist and I really appreciate them saying this. They'll say like, this is going to pinch you a little bit. I need you to stay still. I need you to not move. And I actually really appreciate that about the dentist, that they give me a little bit of warning. This is gonna pinch. Don't move. Because there's a lot of bad things that could happen if I'm flinching in the chair while they're holding something sharp in my mouth. And listen, as gently and as lovingly as I know how to say this, life in this strange world, it's going to hurt. It's going to pinch. So make the decision ahead of time. I'm not moving. I'm following what the Lord has to say. even on those nights when I'm crying myself to sleep, even on those days when I'm so confused about the suffering that I'm going through and I don't understand it, I'm making the decision ahead of time. I'm not moving. I'm gonna sit in that chair and I'm not gonna flinch even when it's difficult. No matter what, make up your mind now that you're not going to move off of trusting the Lord no matter what happens. There will be suffering, there will be heartache, but there is great rest and peace in knowing that the Lord's in control no matter what. And it might hurt a whole lot, but I am not moving. I'm going to follow Jesus for all of my days. No matter what. There's incredible peace in knowing that he's working it. There's blessing coming on the other side of that. That you and I, we have an inheritance that's secure, that's in heaven. It's awaiting us. And it's going to be hard between now and then. And there's going to be days that it pinches. There's going to be suffering and hardship and people reviling us and speaking evil of us and persecution all around us. But no matter what, you have that inheritance. It's not going away. So stand firm and rest as you trust Jesus. So what's your decision in all of that? Will you decide right now that you're going to trust the Lord, that you're going to rest with trust in him? And then finally, how are we to live faithfully even when it's difficult? We're going to answer with hope. Answer with hope. Let's finish reading our passage together, 1 Peter 3:15 and following. 15 again. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense for anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you're slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it's better that you should suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. We're answering with hope those who are around us. Peter begins and uses this terminology. He says that we're to be ready to make a defense. It's a legal terminology. It gives and paints the picture of being in a courtroom and you're called to the stand to make a defense for Jesus Christ, make a defense for what you believe. And if you're called to the stand in a courtroom, silence is not an option. You're required to give a response. And that's what Peter is pointing us to. He urges us to know and then to be ready with the reasons to explain our belief in Jesus Christ. Why do you have such hope in this future inheritance that you have? That's what we're called to be ready for. But notice he says that we should do it with gentleness, with respect. It's not a screaming courtroom, you can't handle the truth sort of thing. It's not that type of response, but we're called to gently and lovingly and respectfully tell of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ, a hope that this world desperately needs. In this strange land, it will get further and further from a biblical worldview, a way of thinking that matches God's word. It's going to continue to wander from that. We shouldn't be surprised that people will find your perspective and my perspective strange. Don't be surprised when people don't think like you do or don't value the things that you value. It's not a surprise to us. It's a strange land. But we're told that we need to be ready with a defense when the situation arises for us to give a defense. You and I, we got to be ready for those things because it's coming. It's like, do you remember in school when everybody was going to be reading a paragraph. We're going through this passage together, this chapter of the book, and everybody's going to read. And we're going to go around the school classroom, and everybody's going to read. And you would stand there and be like, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the paragraph that I'm going to read. You're going to get ready. No? Was I the only? Okay, good. Somebody else in here felt the same way. But that's what I would do. I would like count the paragraphs so that I know. And you read that paragraph ahead of time to make sure there's not any difficult words. I don't know how to pronounce that. I got to get ready. I don't want to stumble over my words. So I'm going to like say it in my head a couple times. I'm not even listening to the other paragraphs. I'm ready for what's going to be required of me. That's what we're called to do. You were prepared for all of that. Now, I don't think Peter means, and I don't mean for a moment, that you have to know the answer to every question that a non-Christian will ever ask you. All of the difficult things that people will try to stump you with, or what, you got to have an articulate, doctorate level answer for all of those kinds of things. I'm not saying that. I don't think that's what Peter is saying either, that you have to have a clever way to say that, to get people's attention and all of that. But I think what he's saying is expect that it's coming, that people will see you as strange because you think differently than they do, because you think like God's word calls us to. And so be ready for that response to come. Be ready for people to think that you're strange. Do you have things that you eat that are a little bit strange? I think a lot of us have something weird that we're like, I kind of eat this, but it's a little weird. So one of the things that I like that admittedly is strange, I like making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. And then, you're on board with that. Just wait. I like making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich and then pouring a big glass of milk and dipping the peanut butter and jelly sandwich in the milk. I'm ready for a defense. Don't knock it till you try it. I can't even get my kids to try this, but I'm telling you, it's so good. It's just like soaked up and you get all of the goodness together. But every time that I have told people about my fun peanut butter and jelly dipped in milk, every time I know that I have to give a defense for it. Because I know what people's response is. They're like, peanut butter and jelly, great, dipped in milk. You have to give a defense for that. I gotta be ready for it. And that's what Peter is talking. We're a little bit weird to the culture around us. People don't understand the way that you think or the way that I think or the way that we act. And they're going to act. Why do you do that? Why do you act that way? Why do you do that? They think it's strange. Following Jesus in this world is strange. And the people you know that you go to work with, you go to school with, that live around you, they think that you are strange. And that's okay. We think that they're strange too at times because you are strange. You and I, we don't belong here. This isn't our home. We're just passing through this place. We belong in heaven. That's where our inheritance is. That's where our home is. And so we're not going to look like this kingdom. We're going to look like the heavenly kingdom, a land that has different values and different priorities than this strange land. And at times, you're going to be asked for why you are so strange. Why don't you do the same things that other people do? Why don't you go to those same places like they go to? Why don't you treat other people the way that they actually deserve? Why do you show love to someone who's done so much harm to you? Peter's saying, be prepared to give an answer to those things, to give an answer for the ways that you act according to God's word, but also for the faith that you have in Jesus Christ, for the hope, because the world does not understand it. And maybe the way that you need to be prepared is to actually take some time this week and study a little bit, to know the answers of some of the questions that people might ask in your life so that you are ready with a specific answer, not necessarily a doctorate level articulate answer. I'm going to send them a zinger or anything like that, but to be ready with an answer to those things. Now, I have found that there really are only a couple of questions that people ask. There's not like 42 of them. There's like six that people ask. And so maybe you need to take some time to, can I give a defense for some of these things? For the reasons why I believe what I believe. Can you answer some of the questions? Why do you believe there's a God, especially when there's so much suffering and evil in this world? Why do you believe that Christianity is the only true religion when there's a whole bunch of religions out there? Why do you believe that homosexual acts are morally wrong? Why do you believe that the Bible can actually be trusted? Why do you believe that Christianity is true when science has so clearly proven that it's wrong? How can you say that God is loving when, according to you, he sends people to hell? Now, I'm not saying that, again, that you need to have a doctorate-level answer to all of these things, but having no answer at all for people is not really an option for us. We need to be prepared because people will ask these questions. And it's not memorizing a series of facts. It's not like a party line. You got to say this kind of things. But know the reasons that you believe what you believe. Because a dying world needs us to deliver the hope in Jesus Christ. That's how God has ordained it, that you and I are the missionaries, the deliverer of hope, the hope dealers to a world that desperately needs Jesus Christ. And Peter's so clear in calling us to this. Now, listen, if someone brings up an answer to a question that you don't know the answer to, it's totally fine. And it's perfectly fine to say something like, you know, that's actually a really good question. Can I get back to you on that with the depth of an answer that question actually deserves? That's totally fine. Now, actually get back to the person. Don't, like, use that as a smokescreen and be like, I'm going to avoid them. But, like, actually do a little study and get back to them on that. There's tons and tons of places that you could go to for resources, and I thought about giving you a whole bunch, and I'm not going to do that. Because I actually think that you finding those things is super helpful for you. I'm only going to give you one that I think is super helpful if you need kind of a head start. There's a website called gotquestions.org, gotquestions.org. You go to the website, there's a box in the middle of it, and you just type in your question, and it'll give you a whole bunch of articles. You can send people who don't believe in Jesus to that place, and they can type in their own questions. I think even better is if there's questions that they ask that you don't know, go there. Why does a loving God send people to hell? Enter. And it will give you a whole bunch of great articles on that. It's a great evangelical resource, gotquestions.org. I think it's great. I think for us, though, a lot of times it's like an infielder in baseball. You know, that infielder needs to learn how to take a ground ball. They need some practice on how's that ball going to come off the bat, and then once I get the ball, what am I supposed to do with it? There's runners on first and second, so now what do I do? Oh, there's not a force, so now what do I do? That infielder needs to learn some things, needs to take some time to actually study and learn some of those things. Maybe you need to take some time to be ready, be prepared by learning some of those answers to those things. But that's not the only way that an infielder in baseball needs to be ready. Because the infielder could know all of those things and know what to do when I get the ball, but be standing there with their hands in their pocket, you know, their baseball glove on their head, like a good little league infielder. They're not ready for that ball to come. Instead, they have their glove ready, their eyes are forward, they're crouched down on the balls of their feet. They are ready. They're prepared for that to come. And I have found most of the time as believers, as churchgoers, that our problem in being ready isn't that we don't know what to do with the ball when we get it. It's not that we don't know how to handle a ground ball. It's that we're sitting there with our hands in our pockets when people around us need the hope. That I need to be prepared and see it as my responsibility and your responsibility. Not just those people who are employed by the church. They're the ones who are to give a response. So Peter would say to all of us that we all should be ready. that as you go about your life in this strange world, you should have glove on, balls of your feet ready to give a defense for the hope that is in you. That's what we're called to do. Most of us don't, I think, have a problem with not knowing. Most of us have a problem with not taking responsibility, of not being ready. We assume someone else will handle it, will answer that question. It's not my job. No, it is your job. Each of us are to be ready to give a response. So are you ready? Can you give an answer for the hope that you have in Jesus Christ? Because we're people in a strange land, in a place that doesn't make sense to us a lot of times, and we don't make sense to the people of this land a lot of times. We have a different mindset and a different worldview. And so we're called to live in these ways, even when it's hard, even when there's pressure from the outside world, when there's persecution or suffering or reviling, even when it's hard, we're to seek to do these things. Are you seeking to love with humility? Are you seeking to repay with blessing? Are you seeking to rest with trust? Are you seeking to answer with hope? You aren't supposed to look like the world around you who doesn't follow Jesus Christ. But even when it's hard, we can live faithfully for him as a chosen race, as a royal priesthood, as a holy nation, and a people for his own possession. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for this call to us to live in this strange land in a way that honors you. We thank you for the way that you continue to instruct us and call us to live out these realities. We are grateful for all that you've accomplished for us in Jesus Christ, for calling us out of darkness and into the light, for calling us to an eternal hope that we have, a secure inheritance that's awaiting us in heaven. And God, we pray that we would live as citizens of heaven, even as we are in this land. We would pray that you would use us to reach a world all around us who desperately need the hope of Jesus Christ. We will make the decision ahead of time, Lord, to follow you, to serve you and to trust you no matter what. God, give us the strength, give us the perseverance to do that even now. We pray that you would give us great peace in resting, knowing that you are in control of it all. When things are difficult and we don't understand, we can rest securely in who you are and what you've accomplished and in what's waiting for us as a people for your own possession. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond.
When I feel your favor flood my life, even in the good I follow you, even in the good I follow you. When the boat is tossed upon the waves, when I wonder if you keep me safe, even in the storms I follow you, even in the storms I'll follow you.
Come on, I believe.
I believe everything that you say you are. I believe and I have seen your unchanging heart, in the good things, in the hardest part. I believe and I will follow you. I believe and I will follow you. When I see the wicked prospering, when I feel I have no voice to sing, even in the ones I'll follow you, even in the ones I'll follow.
I believe every
So far from home, and you lead me somewhere that I don't wanna go. Even in my death, I'll follow you. Even in my death, I'll follow you.
Come on.
When I come to win this race I run, and I receive the prize that Christ has won. Yes, I will be.
How many of you are glad that you were here today? Amen? Amen? I don't know about you, church, but this has been a very challenging, but at the same time, encouraging series, right? Because there's a lot of times when we come and the world can just be so hard, and life can be so hard. But we are reminded of who we belong to and who we are, right? When you know who you are, when you know your identity and who He says that you are, it helps us take on anything that comes our way, right? And that's why when you go out of this place as a representative of Christ, as an ambassador of Christ, wherever He has you, in that mission field that He has put you, your family, your work, your home, your community, like we say in Harvest in Español, no se olviden que son amados. Do not forget that you are loved. Amen.